It'll be a long while before we get another trilogy like we did from Tom Holland's Home trilogy. Amidst the rapid-fire releases of Marvel as they slowly transition into another Avengers-type project, I'm grateful that we were able to see the conclusion of Peter Parker's story arc as we did in this trilogy before including Spider-Man into more multiversal mayhem. It's good that Spider-Man often belongs in the many groups that he features in, but Spider-Man has always been an excellent hero on his own, both in terms of character and storytelling. But there was one thing that the Home trilogy took its time in highlighting, a frequent factor in being a hero, and that is belonging. You know, just like J. Jonah Jameson always points out, is Spider-Man a hero or a menace? Part of what makes up the DNA of Spider-Man is in the youth. Peter Parker is generally portrayed as this young adult with a wisecracking attitude and an optimistic shine in his superhero shenanigans. And as with all people, especially at this age range, it helps to have a place where they can belong. And the Home trilogy was not shy in addressing this kind of issue. There is not a stark focus on this up until No Way Home, but it is certainly a personal conflict for Peter Parker throughout his superhero career. In Civil War, he's asked by Tony Stark, the Iron Man, to provide support against Captain America's defiant group of heroes. Bear in mind, Peter is roughly 15 years old and still figuring out the whole superhero shtick. He's very impressionable and doesn't know the whole truth of why Iron Man and Captain America are fighting. His inexperience is a standout contrast to the veterans around him. This is as prominent in both Infinity War and Endgame, where he impulsively gets himself into severe levels of danger. It's for the right reasons, of course, but his youth and unrefined talents are put on full display. In Homecoming, the night and day life of Spider-Man and Peter Parker respectively is imbalanced. Peter has a life he wants to live, social events and dreams he wants to live up to, and even a girl he has a crush on. But as a rookie Spider-Man, he's faced up against disgruntled supervillains willing to do anything to get their way, which means sacrificing time and opportunities as Peter as he acts on his own heroic nature. He does his best, but he's still not cut out completely with independent superhero work at an above-your-friendly-local-neighborhood level. Nevertheless, he does prove that he can do it, but at the cost of some social expectations, aka placing your would-be girlfriend's father under arrest. That's the first movie. Far From Home, the second movie, features the same imbalance, but constantly in motion as Peter brings out his spidey talents to combat these random elemental strikes. Peter has to conceal both his identity and his formal connections to the SHIELD agency at the most random times, placing suspicion on his shoulders. And during this time, he has the burden of essentially carrying out Tony Stark's legacy and living up to the high expectations of SHIELD. His confidence is heavily damaged by the reasonable distrust of SHIELD, his friends, and by the betrayal of Jake Gyllenhaal, aka Mysterio. With so many deceptions he's had to endure, also a train, Peter eventually puts aside his personal doubts and trusts completely in the potential of his Spider-Man powers, and is able to disable the swarms of drones commanded by Mysterio, reobtain the trust of his friends and colleagues, and defeat Mysterio using his Spider-Sense.
You can't trick me anymore.
But not without losing his public image in the process. In a final gambit by Mysterio, his true identity is broadcast alongside a damaging but false video showing Spider-Man executing Mysterio. No one bothers to ask why or to dig deeper into the mystery of Spider-Man apparently turning evil or why Mysterio would have broadcast something like this so suddenly. Where was SHIELD to address this problem at this scale? From the streets of New York to the hallways of his own school, Peter has become an outcast. It's not his fault, but the world has assembled itself a mob mentality at a speed literally faster than reason.
Peter, you may have dodged your legal troubles, but things will get much worse. There is still a court of public opinion.
If Peter didn't already belong as a fledgling superhero trying to do his best to do the right thing, then he would never find a place in a world where everyone thought he was in the wrong. Some other superheroes have cause to doubt, like Strange and Daredevil, but Peter was effectively alone. Not only that, the sensational news of Spider-Man has dramatically affected the lives of those closest to him, again, of no fault to them. Socially blacklisted and academically cut off, Peter's future was at its bleakest reality. Still, it doesn't stop him from being the friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. In fact, these experiences have increased his empathy.
Ow.
I'm sorry, sir, but...
I have to try.
When villains across the multiverse start popping up left and right, he goes out of his way to try and send them home, even doing his best to fix their own personal problems. Despite his own hardships, Peter's awareness and good-hearted character shines when faced with clear injustice. However, after Green Goblin suddenly betrays Peter, sets loose the supervillains, and takes the life of Aunt May, Peter's most memorable lesson is learned.
And with great power, there must also come great responsibility.
It seemed the world just wanted to take more and more out of an exile with broken dreams. At his lowest point, there was no one he could turn to. His friends could be in danger, and the public certainly wasn't about to change their outlook on him just because of a death in the family. In these absurdly complicated circumstances, enter the Spider-Man.
Sorry.
It's quite fortunate that both Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man are relatively older and more mature than Tom Holland's. Insane a crossover as it is, the three Spider-Men coming together is also probably the best way that Tom Holland's Peter Parker is able to find those meaningful connections that evolve his character to the next level. And what better way for one Spider-Man to learn than from two other Spider-Men? There's unique contrasts and similarities between the Spider-Man 2. Tobey Maguire was bailed out and even idolized by the crowds of NYC at the end of the first movie, even being hailed as a hero while he was carried away to safety. Meanwhile, in spite of everything Spider-Man had done up to No Way Home, he's ostracized so quickly that there was virtually no time for him to make a difference in public opinion. Andrew's Spider-Man lost the love of his life to a Green Goblin. Tom's Spider-Man lost Aunt May to a Green Goblin. Except it was Andrew's fault in the former, not Tom's fault in the latter. These strange connections helped form a most unusual bond between these superheroes, at such a frequency that only those three would be able to understand. For once as a superhero, Spider-Man felt he could belong. And I think that that was the final thing that Peter would learn in the broken world he resides in. He would always stand out, and he would always feel out of place. Not because he's Peter Parker, but because of what he fights for as Spider-Man. Sometimes I wondered why Spider-Man was always so young. Whether it's Peter, Miles, Gwen, or most other Spider-Men, they're typically young adults. That awkward phase in life where everything is starting to make sense, but we have no clue what to believe in. Or rather, our conviction in the things that we believe in is tested in many confusing ways. Example, the final battle against Green Goblin and the planning scene beforehand. It's a classic, do I finish him off or do I spare his life moral conundrum.
Gotta cure all of them, right?
Right.
That's what we do.
But it's especially important for Peter because, bear in mind, this version of Peter is just getting into college. Superheroing is part of his life, but it is not the focus. Because, well, he has a life. Peter has friends, family, school, and aspirations beyond the villain of the week. Now that virtually all of these things have been stolen from him, what is he gonna do? And when one of those things was robbed by an antagonist he had willingly spared, what will he do? At this point, everything Peter had believed in, had looked forward to, had prepared for all his life, had crumbled in front of his very eyes. All that remained was him, his powers, and his morals. And when faced with Green Goblin for a rematch, what would he do if he obtains victory? Ultimately, he chooses mercy and spares and cures Norman of his insanity, as he had with the other supervillains, with the help of the other Spider-Men. And with Doctor Strange wiping out the memory of his true identity across the multiverse, Peter Parker's fate was essentially a reset. He has a future, an uncertain future, but a future that he could shape according to his own will. And he's changed remarkably. No one may know his true identity anymore, but Peter knows who he is and always will be. The hero. The one who fights for the rights when no one else will. He has come to realize that he would be one among a rare few to stand up against the forces of evil wherever it appeared. An unsung champion who makes difficult decisions with difficult odds stacked against him. A defender who takes the higher road in an effort to preserve the world they reside in. In other words, a true hero. But for Peter, a Spider-Man. Ultimately, most heroes are like that. They stand out because of the pursuit and preservation of their ideals. They'll feel out of place, but that is because what they seek for is ultimately more than what their setting demands of them. It's not what the world wants, but what the world needs. There's entire superhero legacies where prejudice is a consistent factor in their history and the way they've played out, like the X-Men. So it's interesting to see a Spider-Man whose back is against the wall, not because of villains, but because of their environment. It provides a window into the heart and mind of the character, in this case, Peter Parker, as his true colors are revealed in such a dire situation. And ultimately, Peter is a young man, a human, no different than others, with hopes and aspirations. Naive, perhaps, but optimistic and good-hearted, if not confused and prone to his impulses. We see what he truly desires in life. In this case, a future. Because he was robbed of a future by the deathly wishes of a master manipulator, what's left is who he is, a good-hearted and optimistic person. And just in general for Spider-Man, even superheroes like Peter, it's against their better nature to conform to the ever-changing opinions of the world at large. Not everyone has the privilege of being known as a reliable hero like Captain America and Iron Man.
I am Iron Man.
Because the circumstances of their superhero careers seldom cater to a public persona that is respected by everybody. There's a reason why superheroing is sometimes a night and day thing. It's why a character like J. Jonah Jameson is such a memorable Spider-Man antagonist. But in the end, that does not matter to them. What matters is doing the right thing. What matters is justice, the safety of the people, and countless other reasons by which these heroes continue to risk their lives. In this example, the difference between a hero and a commoner is this: that the former is willing to shape their perception and their reality above the shifting trends and status quo of the world around them, that they are willing to work and persist past the accepted present, and rise above opinions and perspectives formed from a collective world at large in order to tackle the deepest needs of the world they inhabit. It's the hero's journey, but it can often be a lonely affair. I've talked about belonging and transitioned over to how what matters is doing the right thing. In most superhero stories, it comes down to that same legendary quote we've all heard before: with great power comes great responsibility. And as countless comic books, movies, and video games will tell you, using that great power responsibly will paint a target on someone's back. So, perhaps those that strive for higher idealisms and a more perfect world will fall out of place.
S.H.I.E.L.D. takes the world as it is, not as we'd like it to be. It's getting damn near past time for you to get with that program, Cap.
Don't hold your breath.
And those that stand for what they believe in might catch the bullet of opinionated differences. At the end of the day, they might not belong, and they'll face hardship because of that. But the least that they can do is see through their lives in the pursuit of what they believe in. There's comfort in knowing that the ultimate sense of fulfillment will come from completely staying true to the course that heroes like Spider-Man have set their feet in, to stand by the measure of their personal characters. It may be tough, it may be hard fought, it may take sacrifices, but it is doing the right thing. Just ask Peter Parker.